In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brethren, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Created the dignity of human nature and still more wonderfully restored it. Grant, we pray, that we may share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings glad tidings, announcing peace, bearing good news, announcing salvation, and saying to Zion, your God is King. Hark, your sentinels raise a cry. Together they shout for joy, for they see directly before their eyes the Lord restoring Zion. Break out together in song, O ruins of Jerusalem. For the Lord comforts his people. He redeems Jerusalem. The Lord has bared his holy arm in the sight of all the nations. All the ends of the earth will behold the salvation of our God. The word of the Lord. A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, in times past, God spoke in partial and various ways to our ancestors through the prophets. In these last days, he has spoken to us through the Son, whom he made heir of all things, and through whom he created the universe, who is the refulgence of his glory, the very imprint of his being, and who sustains all things by his mighty word. When he had accomplished purification from sins, he took his seat at the right hand of the Majesty on high, as far superior to the angels, as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. For to which of the angels did God ever say, "You are my son, this day I have begotten you"? Or again, "I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me"? And again, when he leads the firstborn into the world, he says, "Let all the angels of God worship him." The word of the Lord.
Oh.
Be with you.
Yes,
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came to be through him, and without him nothing came to be. What came to be through him was life, and this life was the light of the human race. The light that shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. A man named John was sent from God. He came for testimony, to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to testify to the light. The true light which enlightens everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came to be through him. But the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, but his own people did not accept him. But to those who did accept him, he gave power to become children of God. And to those who believe in his name, who were born not by natural generation, nor by human choice, nor by a man's decision, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we saw his glory, the glory as of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. John testified to him and cried out, saying, "This was he of whom I said, 'The one who is coming after me ranks ahead of me because he existed before me.' From his fullness we have all received grace in place of grace, because while the law was given through Moses, grace and truth come through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. The only Son, God, who is at the Father's side, has revealed him." The Gospel of the Lord. The priests and brothers of the Canons Regular of St. John Cantius wish all of you and your families a very, very merry Christmas. May you experience our Lord's blessings abundantly during these 8 days of the Christmas octave and throughout the entire Christmas season. Please note our modified schedule of Masses during the octave of Christmas. On weekdays, this coming week, morning prayers and Mass begin 1 hour later. We welcome our parishioners as well as visitors from Chicago and beyond for Christmas Masses. For those who are visiting and do not share our Catholic faith, we welcome you to experience the patrimony and heritage of the Catholic Church's liturgy. But we ask that only practicing Catholics receive communion. Today's Mass is offered for the intention of the United States of America. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. When Caesar Augustus was born in the year 27 BC, it was said that a new era had begun. Seen somewhat as a savior, Augustus was regarded not just as a politician, but as a theological figure. He brought peace to the world, and for the first time, peoples and nations were united with a common law and language in an empire that spanned the entire known world. Under his reign began a long period of relative peace called the Pax Augusti. Even though Augustus Caesar was, in his time, worshipped as a god, we know that he was merely an earthly savior, savior with a small s. However, God has often worked through the world, its peoples, and events to prefigure and accomplish his plan of salvation. So it was because of the unity of the known world within one empire, and during a long period of peace, that the true Savior, Jesus Christ, could enter the world to bring his message of universal salvation and spread throughout that entire empire. It was, as St. Paul wrote in his letter to the Galatians, the fullness of time when God sent forth his Savior, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. Well, what the great Caesar Augustus claimed for himself was realized in a loftier way in the defenseless and powerless child born in a Bethlehem cave. Both Augustus and Christ brought peace to the world, but of different natures. Peace that Jesus Christ brought was not necessarily opposed to the peace of worldly affairs brought about by Augustus. Yet the peace of Christ surpasses the peace of Augustus as heaven surpasses the earth. As Pope Benedict XVI once wrote, the difference is that from the moment of his birth, Jesus Christ belongs outside the realm of what is important and powerful in worldly terms. Yet it is this unimportant and powerless child that proves to be the truly powerful one, the one on whom ultimately everything depends. So one aspect of becoming a Christian is having to leave behind what everyone else thinks and wants, the prevailing standards, in order to enter the light of the truth of our being, and aided by that light, to find the right path. The letter to the Hebrews stated for us today that in times past, God spoke in partial and various ways to our ancestors through the prophets. In these last days, he has spoken to us through the Son, whom he made heir of all things and through whom he created the universe. It was in him that the Logos, the creative logic behind all things, entered the world. The eternal Logos became man. The Logos, the Word, had existed from all time. And in those profound words from the beginning of the Gospel of St. John that we heard today, the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came to be through him, and without him, nothing came to be. And this Word, through whom all things came to be, became one of us, and on this day was born a small little baby in a cave. When the angel appeared to the shepherds watching their flocks in the field that fateful night long ago, he said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I proclaim to you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For today in the city of David a Savior has been born for you, who is Messiah and Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men of good will." But today, unfortunately, many people are afraid because of all that is happening in our world. For some, there is no joy. We say, especially at Christmas, that the Savior brought salvation and peace to all mankind. But it sometimes seems more and more as if that peace and goodwill to all men is rapidly fading from our world. with all of the distressing news of things happening around us. But we always have to remember that Christ never promised true peace, total peace in this world, only peace in the life to come. And until then, he promised peace within our hearts, those who accept him, knowing that he has saved us. 160 years ago, Henry Wadsworth Longfellow felt a lack of peace and hope in his world. He wrote of how the joy of Christmas seemed to disappear in the midst of the conflict and hatred within the world. But in his poem, Christmas Bells, he wrote that he continued to listen to the bells of Christmas. As he did so, he found that they truly did bring tidings of goodwill and hope. I heard the bells on Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play. And in despair, I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said, for hate is strong. Then pealed the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail. With peace on earth, goodwill to men. We too need to keep telling ourselves that wrong will eventually fail and the right will prevail, and that Christmas does bring us the good news that we are saved and that we have eternal life together with that little child born 2,000 years ago. That when the Word became flesh, he brought true hope. That at every Christmas, no matter what's happening, should fill our hearts with joy that our God has become one of us and has saved us for himself. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory. And it was the light that shone in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men of goodwill forever. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. And I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. On this joyful day, when the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, let us turn to his Father and our Father in heaven and place before him our petitions. For all Christians, that they will truly feel today, and not only feel but know that there is the hope of eternal life together with our Lord when this world and all its trials pass away. We pray to the Lord. For our government, for our leaders, that they may come to know not just the joy and hope of Christmas, but that they will come to know the truth that the little child brought and lead us in truth and justice. We pray to the Lord. For all of those who today find themselves abandoned, perhaps in despair, alone, homeless, not enough to meet their own needs, we pray to the Lord. And for an increase in vocations to the priesthood and the religious life, especially to the canons regular of St. John Cantius, we pray to the Lord. Lord God in heaven, we turn to you with our petitions and ask that you hear them and grant them in the name of your Son and our Lord, the Word who has become flesh. Amen.
Amen.
my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty God.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for praise and glory of his name, for our good and all of his holy church.
Make acceptable, O Lord, our oblation on this solemn day when you manifested the reconciliation that makes us wholly pleasing in your sight, and inaugurated for us the fullness of divine worship, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for in the mystery of the Word made flesh, a new light of your glory has shone upon the eyes of our mind, so that as we recognize in him God made visible, we may be caught up through him in love of things invisible. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Blaise, our Bishop, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants. And all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. Celebrating the most sacred day on which Blessed Mary, the Immaculate Virgin, brought forth the Savior of this world, and in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord, Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogenus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers in all things, we may be defended by your protecting help, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands. And once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection. I still do come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension to heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, the spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing through Christ our Lord. Amen. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace, through Christ our Lord. Amen. To us also, your servants, who though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord. Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
For thy kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. On your
takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy to enter your presence,
but only say the word, my soul shall be.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Grant, O merciful God, that just as the Savior of the world born on this day is the author of divine generation for us, so he may be the giver even of immortality, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.